know that we are in a new year.
All right.
We have pledged, many of us, to do new things, right? To let go of some of the old things. You know, the new year has a certain different thing about it, right? The new year, we see the fireworks, right? We eat our blackout peas and our collard greens. We go to the midnight services. We do these things that signify a new start has begun. A new year has begun. It's time for change.
Yes,
right? There are people in America today that they make New Year's resolutions.
Oh, yeah.
And yes. A resolution is a firm decision to do or not to do something. Now, we have some who would say that their decision is to lose weight. Some say that they're going to spend less and save more. Others say they're going to be more organized. Some say, I'm going to fall in love this year. Some say, I'm going to quit smoking this year. But I was looking at something online, and it showed that majority of the time, after 6 months, many people fall off. And it says that only what usually happens is only 8% stick to the resolution. I didn't say 8% do not fail. They give up on their resolutions. And what I want to speak to you about this morning is a resolution that I believe that we all should share in. And this resolution is a resolution to renounce.
All right.
Now, what do I mean by that? Now, to renounce something is to say that I deny doing this any longer. To renounce something is to say that I no longer want to be a part of this thing that I was a part of. Now, you see, in our resolution as Americans, we become lax, right? And sometimes we lack the willpower because we have a lot of things in our favor, right? We have a lot of freedoms that we are accustomed to. In Texas, now we can even carry our guns on our hips like the Wild Wild West. So in our freedom as Americans, sometimes we get lax and we forget about these things and we lack the willpower to finish out on our resolutions. But I believe that this resolution to renounce our old way of life can be accomplished. And I believe that can be accomplished because we have three things on our side. We have the Holy Spirit, the gift of the Holy Spirit. We have God the Father, and we have God the Son. These three things will allow us to accomplish our resolution in the year of 2016. The title for the sermon this morning is A Resolution to Renounce. We all in here have come from a place of darkness, a place of sin. Some of us in here have been people who have committed adultery. Some of us in here have been people who have broken the law. Some of us in here have been people who have stolen. Some of us have lied, cheated, done all sorts of things that were not of God. We've been those things, right? We must not forget. We can't forget where we came from, right? Unless we fall back into it. We've all come from these places, but through baptism, we're changed. And we go from being darkness itself into being light. And this change occurs through Christ Jesus. Through baptism, we're able to change into something new, something positive. So, Paul, and what we're talking about today, Paul, he first began in this book of Ephesians by stating the things that God has done for us. He says that through baptism, we are given forgiveness of our sins. We start off with a clean slate. We are given forgiveness of our sins.
All right.
We are told that we are now having an inheritance of heaven. We're told that we can now be in heaven with God. And we're also told that we're given the mark of the Holy Spirit, which signifies to God upon his return who we are. He says, that's my child. That's who I've changed. That's who can be with me for an eternity. But then Paul continues on in this book of Ephesians, this letter to the church in Ephesus, and he says, you've been given these things, but now you have a responsibility to do something for God. He says, I want you to imitate God. I want you to look like him. But we live in a society, we live in a time where sin is glorified, where it's okay to steal. Some of us in here, this weekend we got our fresh cuts. We got those bootleg movies from the barbershop. Yeah, that's stealing. We live in a society that says that same-sex marriage is okay because it's love. Because it's consensual, it's okay. This is the type of era that we live in. And just like those in Ephesus, we live in an evil time. And Paul, he paints a picture on how it is that we are to live as Christians in a world that's evil. Let's turn our Bibles to Ephesians chapter 5. We're going to read verses 3 through 20. I'll be reading from the NRSV version. Say amen when you get there.
Amen.
Say wait if you're not there. Ephesians chapter 5, we'll be reading verses 3 through 20. And it reads, "But fornication and impurity of any kind or greed must not even be mentioned among you, as is proper among saints. Entirely out of place is obscene, silly, and vulgar talk. But instead, let there be thanksgiving. Be sure of this, that no fornicator or impure person, or one who is greedy, that is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words. For because of these things, the wrath of God comes on those who are disobedient. Therefore, do not be associated with them. For once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of the light. For the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, sleeper awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand that understand what the will of the Lord is. Verse 18. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." Again, I want to say it's a blessing to be here this morning with you all, and I believe that this resolution to renounce our former ways of life is possible. It's good to have my brother-in-law here, my sister's
brother.
Your sister's
brother?
Doesn't make any
sense. Tony. We have Tony here this morning as well. Diving into this text, we need to remember what the city of Ephesus is. This city, this ancient city, is a city where people worship other gods. These other gods that they worship, the main god that they worship is Diana or Artemis, as we've spoken of before. And this goddess is one who is said to control fertility and also hunting and animals. And the worship of Diana involved sex. They didn't come into the temple of Diana and sing songs and pray. They came and they did certain things, right? This is how they worshiped at that time. This is a city that this church is set in the middle of, that Paul is writing to. This church in Ephesus, he's writing to a church that's surrounded by these people who worship this goddess, right? And this temple that they had in Ephesus was huge. It was said that he could seat 25,000 people. And on a yearly basis, they would come into this temple and they would worship this goddess Diana in the month of May. And what would happen is, these people would come here and they would worship her in the temple. And then and if you look at the book of Acts, there's a dispute. And Paul is ready to go into this temple full of 25,000 people to talk about the one true God. This church is in the center of people who believe that worship to this false god involves sex and impure things. This city, this church in this city is the minority. This church in this city is surrounded by people who will come after them if they tell them that their worship is wrong. This is what this church is dealing with. And Paul here says in someone read verses 3 and 4 for me. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 3 and 4.
But fornication.
And all uncleanness.
Or covetousness.
Let it not be once named among you.
As becometh saints.
So what he's saying right here, that this fornication, that word that's used there, is talking about any kind of sexual sin. It's talking about fornication, which is sex outside of marriage. It's talking about adultery, which is sex with someone who isn't your spouse. It's talking about sodomy. All these different forms of sexual sin that they engage in around them, he says that this must not be named around you. What does it say after that? What else?
Neither filthiness.
This is talking about any other immoral thing that can be done. And he says what? What else?
Nor foolish talking.
Oh, go back up.
Verse 3. But fornication.
Okay.
And all uncleanness.
That's talking about all moral things. What else?
Or covetousness.
This right here describes something. And this means that, do you know what it means to covet? This means that you want more than what's necessary. Right? We are a people in a day and time who are earth people. Y'all know what that means? What that means is we want to be better than the next person. We want a bigger house. We want a better car. We want a slimmer waist. We want a tighter body. We are earth people. And that's what covetousness is. It's wanting to have more than what's necessary. Do I need a six pack? No. Do I want one? Yes. Do I need a bigger house? No. I have a roof over my head, right? It keeps me protected from the elements. Right? I have food in my house. I don't have T-bones, but I have food in my house. It's what's necessary. But whenever we begin to covet other things, when we begin to want for things that are not necessary, it poses a problem. Let me just say that right after covetousness.
Let it not be named amongst you.
He said, let it not be named among you. What he's saying there is that these sins that I have mentioned here, people shouldn't even be able to look at this church and say that this goes on in here. He said, I don't want it to be named here. I don't want it to look at somebody within your church and say, I think that person is involved with this sin. I think this person is involved with that sin. These sins that he's talking about right here are outward sins that these people are committing in the city. And then in verse 4, he goes on to say what?
Neither filthiness. Nor foolish talking. Nor jesting.
Which are not convenient.
But rather giving of thanks.
So what he says here, he says, this obscene living, this living that is not normal for society, is wrong. Then he talks about their speech. He says, the vulgar language that's used, the clever, witty sarcasm that's used. He said, this is not proper for saints. Now, I did some reading up on this, and I seen that the people in Ephesus were famous for their playwrights. Y'all heard Shakespeare, right? Yeah. Well, they had people who wrote plays in the city of Ephesus, and I looked at one such play. It was called The Braggart Soldier. And this play involved a prostitute who was kidnapped. And she, in the story, she's the damsel in distress. Right? And this slave goes and tries to save this prostitute who belongs to his master. And they use all kinds of crude language and these images that are not good for us. And it made me think back to my Orange is the New Black days on Netflix. And I thought, is it necessary to use such language? Is it necessary to use such imagery to tell a story? Every one of us in here has read Dr. Seuss, right? Dr. Seuss didn't even use real words, yet they were entertaining books, right? He's saying that we don't need to be involved with language that's obscene, language that is vulgar. This language does nothing to build up. We talked about that the last time I'm here. the last time I was here, we talked about how we ought to speak. We shouldn't use words that tear down, but we should always use words to
build up.
What building up is there in foul language? What building up is there in telling bad jokes? Using lowbrow humor. There's no building up in it. There's no good in it. So Paul gives a suggestion here at the end of verse 4. It says what?
For this we know. For this ye know.
Okay.
That no whoremonger.
Read verse 4.
Verse 4. Verse 4 says. Neither filthiness.
Okay.
That's no foolish take talking. No jesting,
all right,
which are not convenient,
okay,
but by the giving of thanks.
So what he says is, instead of using this language that is not useful for building up, he says, I want you to give thanks.
Right.
Yes.
I want you to give thanks for the blessings that you have in your life.
Amen.
You see, in this section that we've been looking at in this letter to Paul, he tells them about the bad things that they've been doing in their life and the bad things that are around them. He says, instead of doing these things, I want you to do this. He said, the person that steals, I want you to now work hard and give to others. He said, the person who lies, I want you to tell the truth.
Yeah.
And here he says to those who are involved with the use of bad language, he says, instead of using language that does not build up, I want you to give thanks. I want you to give thanks. He says that for a reason. You see, sometimes we walk around looking so sad, so down and depressed. And when people look at us, they could not tell that we belong to God. They could not tell that God has done anything good in our lives. When God has blessed us with so much. There's a purpose for speaking about your blessings. There's a purpose for doing that. You know, sometimes it seems as though it's annoying when people going around, I'm too blessed to be stressed, too annoying to be. Y'all know that.
Amen.
But it's a good thing, because it's letting people know, look, God has done something for me. And maybe it'll spark something in that person who doesn't realize that God has blessed them. Verse 5, he continues by saying,
For this ye know,
that no whoremonger,
or unclean person,
or covetous man,
who is an idolater,
have any inheritance,
in the kingdom of Christ and of God.
What he says here is that these people who engage in these actions, and he's talking about Christians, listen, these people who engage in these actions, that they have become Christians, he said, they have no inheritance in the kingdom of God. And I want you to know that verb that's used there is present tense verb. So what he's saying here is that they don't have to wait until the judgment. Here presently, while they're engaging in these sins, they have no inheritance in heaven. If someone is a Christian and they engage in these sinful things, they do not have a place in heaven. Even though they've been baptized, even though they wear the name of a Christian. And this isn't just a set of things that a Christian can't do. This is something that Paul is using because this is around them. But this is sin in general.
Yes.
All right. Mm-hmm. You know, I've been going to the, well, I went one time this past week to the gym. And while I was on the treadmill, I had to watch the TV because my headphones had died. But I was looking at Maury Povich. Y'all know that show?
Oh.
So I'm looking at Maury Povich, reading what the people are saying on the screen. And Maury Povich has turned from a talk show into a fraternity circus.
Oh, yeah.
And what happens is, someone comes out, and this man or this lady, she points at the screen, and there's a baby on the TV, and she says, "You have the eyes of the father. He has your eyes. This baby has your mouth. This baby has your nose. This baby has your ears," right? And so they come out, and they're doing all this yelling and screaming and neck shaking and finger pointing. And then Maury sits there, and he has an envelope in his hand. Right? And Maury Povich has this envelope in his hand. And then he says, well, we don't have to guess anymore about whether or not he's the father. We're going to look at this paternity test, which checked the DNA, and we're going to see if you are the father. And so either they are the father or not. So they pull out and they say, you are not the father. And the mother runs backstage. She's all devastated and torn up. Falls on the couch backstage. So I was thinking about this as we talked about this. And even though we come in here and we've gotten wet through baptism, Even though we come in here and we drink the juice and we eat the small cracker, even though we come in here and we sing the words in the song book, if you don't have God in you, He is not your Father either. Understand that. Understand that even though we put on the actions, we have to have God in us. We have to have the DNA of God in us. And the DNA of God causes us to behave a certain way.
Amen, brother.
Yes. See your father.
Yes. Yes.
That's all right.
Some of us wouldn't like the answer. Some of us be falling out on that couch. So we go back and we look at verse 6. We go back and look at verse 6. It says, "Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things, the wrath of God comes on those who are disobedient." What he's saying right there is, he says, don't let other people tell you that you will be lost for doing these things. You see, remember, they lived in a city of people who really, honestly, truly believed that their worship involved sex with each other. He said, don't let anybody deceive you and tell you that this over here is right.
Yes.
He said, because if you do, you will receive the wrath of God. Verse 7 says, therefore, do not be associated with them. And that word associated is the same word that's used earlier in Ephesians when it describes us being associated with the children of Israel once we come through baptism, right? We're associated with them because we are fellow heirs with them. We now belong to God. And so what that's saying is, he's not saying that you should look at people who sin and say, you know what, I have no parts of you. I don't even want to look at you, right? Because Paul talks about this thing in 1 Corinthians when he talks about how one is would have to leave this world in order to get away from these type of sins. What he's saying here is that we must not engage in the actions of sinful people.
Right.
Verse 8, he tells them to remember. He says what? Verse 8, someone read that.
For you were sometimes darkness.
Now, he doesn't say you were in darkness. He said you were darkness.
Right.
But now, in the Lord, you are light. And what that's saying here, he's saying that at one time, you were lost, right? If we were to turn off the lights and cover the windows, we couldn't see anything in here.
Okay.
But he says, now in the Lord, you are light. And he says that because we are light, we must do what? We must walk.
As children of light.
As children of light. We need to live in a way that says we are Christians. Amen. We need to live in a way that speaks to the world and says, I belong to God.
Amen.
That's our responsibility. All the benefits that we receive as Christians, our responsibility is to live in the world as children of the light. Verse 9, it says, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. He says, try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. We have a responsibility to live as children of the light. He says that living as children of the light has its fruits. It produces something within us that shows up on the outside. How do we know what's good? How do we know what's right? Yeah. They're surrounded by people who say that wrong is right and right is wrong. How do we know? He says we have to figure out what is pleasing to God.
Right.
We have to learn what is pleasing to God. This is what we must do.
All
right. It takes some work on our part.
Yeah.
Verse 11 says what?
And have no fellowship with the unfruitful.
With the unfruitful
works of darkness.
But
rather reprove them.
But instead expose them. He says, have no place with the works of darkness. He said they lack fruit. Picture this. If you plant an apple tree in your yard and it doesn't have fruits, what is it? It's dead. It's dead. It's useless. Yeah, that's right. It's dead. It's useless. So that means the works of darkness do not give forth fruit or life. They lead to death. And I'm not talking about the death that we experience here as Christians. This death is a spiritual one. And the spiritual death lasts forever. Someone read that verse again for me.
And have no fellowship.
Have no fellowship.
With the unfruitful works of darkness.
Don't engage in these works. Continue.
With the unfruitful works of darkness.
All right.
But rather reprove them.
Reprove them. He says, I don't want you to be involved with this. I want you to expose the works of darkness. I want you to point them out. You know, there was a TV show that was on TV the other day, and my daughters were watching it, and it was a Disney movie, right? Mm-hmm. A Disney movie. Mm-hmm. And this Disney movie had these girls, and they talked about, I was in the other room, and I heard one girl say, well, she had a hickey. I said, this is Disney. I said, this girl had a hickey. So I said, Siri, maybe y'all come in here. Because they done heard it already. So what I need to do is, I need to expose this to them so they can know what it is. So that they don't go to school and say, and then one of their little friends say, well, this is what you do when you got a girl. I need to expose to them what it was. So I told them, I said, this hickey thing is what's happening. Y'all don't want to expose to y'all kids if y'all want to. Y'all know what it is. But I told them, I said, this leads to other sins, other bad things, which will lead to other things, and other things on top of that. And I explained it to them in a way that they can understand. And what he's saying here, what Paul is saying here, is that we need to do the same with sin. It's going to hurt. When we watch the television, I know my sister ain't going to like this. When we watching Scandal, and our lady heroine is committing adultery, yet she is the hero. We need to expose that to ourselves and to others around us. That's not something that we should be doing. I had to tell my wife, I had to confess my sins to my wife. I bought a video game. Seems harmless. Grab that bottle. I'm looking at it and I said, you know what? I shouldn't be playing this. I said, the stuff that is on here, not what I should be taking into my heart. You see, we have to expose these things. Why does it say that we need to expose it? Continue reading.
Rather of the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame.
It's a shame.
Even to speak of those things.
Even to speak with those things.
Of them in secret.
Okay, so what he's saying right there, it's a shame to even talk about what they do in secret. That doesn't mean that when we come here to Sunday school that we don't discuss what's wrong. Right. That means we don't need to go into the details of it. All right, continue reading. Right.
But all things,
he said, all things
that are reproved,
reproved, are exposed,
or made manifest,
are made clear and visible
by the light.
And he says, whenever the light comes on that which is dark, it is exposed for what it is.
Right.
It's exposed exactly for what it is. Have you ever seen those bugs that look like leaves, and they wait for some unsuspecting little bug to come by? They thinking that they're crawling on a leaf and then that bug snatch them. And eat them up. Right? We see snakes that do that. We see alligators that'll sit still for a minute. As soon as you get close, they snap up. We have to expose sin for what it is so we can see clearly what exactly it is. So that we can recognize what is good. So we can recognize what is right. Because we too live in a society that says right is wrong and wrong is right. And he continues saying what?
For whatsoever doth make manifest is light.
Whatever is made, whatever is dark is made into light. Continue.
Wherefore, he said, awake thou that sleepest.
Awake those that are asleep.
And arise.
Rise
from the dead.
From the dead.
And Christ shall give thee light.
Paul here says to them that they are not to engage in darkness. He said that they are to engage in things that are of the light. And we need to figure out what it is that is so that we know what is light.
Okay.
How do we do that? You see, instead, there were two things that you did not want to be. One was a snitch. And one was a geek. And nobody liked geeks in class, right? Geeks were those kids who dressed funny and who would go above and beyond what the assignment was, right? You were okay with just answering the question. But these geeks, will go into the library and find out all this extra information, make class longer than what it had to be, because they want to have a conversation with the teacher about the subject, right?
Yeah.
And so these geeks, they had to live through this ostracism, right? They didn't have any friends, usually, or if they did, it was very few. There's only a couple of geeks, right? The ones that lasted, right? And they had to go through this eternity of 4 to 12 years. And then after high school, you get out, and after that 10, 12 years, you go into the doctor's office, and those geeks are now doctors.
Hello. Amen. Amen.
Hello. Geeks are now lawyers.
Yeah.
Because they went the extra mile to figure out things. They went the extra mile to find out what was true. They suffered being outcasts. And what I want you to see here is that we need to be geeks for God.
Well,
we need to be geeks for God. Yeah. We must find out what it is that God wants us to do. And it's not good enough just to be Christians. We need to figure out how it is that we are to live in this world.
Yeah.
We have to be resolute in our renunciation.
All right.
And the only way that we can be resolute in our renunciation is to figure out what it is that we need to do. So we can get rid of all that other stuff. So we can renounce living how we lived in the past. So we can renounce living with the people that we've been living with. So we can be an influence on those who don't belong to God.
Amen.
We have to be resolute in our renunciation. Be geeks for God. Paul continues.
See then, that you walk circumspectly. Not as fools. But as wise. Redeeming the time.
Because
the days are evil.
Okay.
Wherefore,
okay,
be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is.
Stop right there. Paul continues in verse 15 through 20 by telling them not to live as someone who lacks discernment, but live as someone who has an understanding. Someone who applies what they learn. Sometimes we have people who don't apply what they've learned. I remember having friends in school who were smart, intelligent men, or young men. Then they don't finish school. They did not apply what they had learned. It's a shame, right? It's a shame.
Oh, yeah.
Much in the same way, we can't just take our knowledge and not apply it as Christians. He says, I want you to not walk as unwise people, but as wise. He said, I want you to do what? Verse 16, make the most of the time. It's that saying right there. I want you to take every opportunity to figure out what it is that God wants you to do. Read verse 16 for me.
Redeeming the time.
Make the most of this time.
Because the days are evil.
And what he's saying right there, that you need to make the most of every second, every minute, every hour that you have, because these days that we live in are evil, and these things can influence us. We talked about what happens when we are influenced by evil. In chapter 4, it talks about those who are influenced by evil and how they become blind. Unable to recognize anything that belongs to God. If somebody were to talk to you about God, you wouldn't even know that it was God. You wouldn't be able to recognize it. He said, make every effort to recognize what it is that you need to do. Make the most of your time. Continue verse 17, please.
Wherefore, be not unwise.
He said, be not unwise.
But understanding what the will of the Lord is.
Understand what God's will is. He concludes this, or he paints this picture here. Read verse 18 through 24.
And be not drunk.
Be not drunk.
With wine.
With wine.
Wherein is excess.
Wherein is excess.
But be filled. With the Spirit.
With the Spirit.
Speaking to yourselves.
In psalms and hymns.
In spiritual songs.
Singing and making melody.
In your hearts to the Lord.
What he's saying, he paints this image right here. He says, don't be drunk with wine. Don't be intoxicated with wine. And this does two things right here. It gives a commandment to not be intoxicated with wine, right? But it also paints a picture of how it is that we have the Spirit work with us. He says, don't be intoxicated with wine because it is debauchery. That means that it makes us senseless. It makes us to where we don't think about the consequences of our actions. Mm-hmm. He said, but instead, mm-hmm. be full of the Spirit. Mm-hmm. Now, we as Christians have the Spirit within us already. So why does Paul say to have the Spirit in them? Why does Paul tell them to have the Spirit in them, to be full of the Spirit? He's saying that in the same way that alcohol changes your actions, I want you to not just have the Spirit in you, but I want you to allow the Spirit to consume you. I want you to allow the Spirit to consume you. Now, I remember in my club and partying days, there were people who were very quiet that would go to parties. There were people who would not dance. Some would just sit back on the wall. Right? But then, as the party went on, as it got later in the club, they would take a couple of drinks. Right? And gradually, these people, inhibitions would change. They would lower. All of a sudden, these people who were introverts now were great debaters. They would hold conversations, right? And as they drank more, they began to speak more. And then those people who did not dance, they would drink more, and then they would be like John Travolta and dance feet. This alcohol took control of them and changed the way that they acted on the outside. Paul is saying to them, I want you to take so much God into you.
Come on.
I want you to put so much God into you. I want you to be geeks for God in a way to where you consume so much information about God that it changes your actions.
Yes, sir.
And then he goes on to say that whenever you sing, what is it that you do?
Speak it to yourself.
He says, speak to each other.
Yeah.
How?
In song.
In song.
In hymn.
In hymn.
In spiritual
songs.
Singing.
Singing.
And making melody
in your heart
through the Lord.
And here again, he gives a commandment on how we are to worship, but he's saying something more. Whenever we sing songs, we're ministering to each other.
That's right. That's
when
right.
we sing songs, we're teaching each other.
Yeah.
Some of us in here get upset when somebody else isn't singing. That person may be being ministered to at that moment.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
While everybody else is singing, they're listening to these lyrics, and they're thinking about what God has done for them. This is what the Spirit causes you to do. You can sing these songs and truly mean them. And then he says what?
Giving thanks.
Giving thanks. The Spirit causes you to give thanks.
Always.
Always.
For all things.
For all things.
Unto God.
Unto God.
And the Father.
So that means that the Spirit will make a young person who can't do much because they're young, it'll make them be thankful for their youth. Yeah. It'll make the old person who can't do much, make them be thankful for their time. Mm-hmm. It'll make the person in the hospital be thankful for the advancement of medicine.
Yes,
and be thankful for those who come to visit them. The Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
If you allow it to control you, it will cause you to be thankful to where you won't walk around with a sad look on your face.
Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm.
It'll cause you to influence the world by seeing that nothing bothers you. Nothing hurts you in a way that changes your actions and makes you act in opposition to God. This is what the Holy Spirit does. And we must learn what it is that we are to do. But that begins with us renouncing our old way of life. We must be resolute in our renunciation. We must be determined to give up our old way of life. The Holy Spirit will even make you thankful, even though you're tired from having a newborn cry. Make you thankful that the baby is healthy.
Uh-huh.
Their lungs work all right.
Yes.
You see what God has done here? God in Christ has given us a way to not only live as life, but he's given us a way to live in the light.
Mm-hmm.
And this light exposes all the darkness in the world. And it shows others why things are wrong. Mm-hmm. God has given this to us. He's a gift from God. It's not enough that God gave us his son. It's not enough that he gave us salvation. It's not enough that he gave us the Holy Spirit to mark us upon his return. He continues to give.
Yes, sir.
Because that's what God does. He loves to give. Let us have the resolution in 2016 to renounce our old ways of life. If you are a Christian this morning, and you want to make that commitment to renounce your old ways of life, now's the time to do so. If you are not a Christian, and you don't share in our religious conviction, I want you to realize that you lack in a lot of gifts that God has for you. God wants you to have these gifts. He wants for you to be able to partake in these things that he has for every single one of us. The thing that you must do is you must hear the word of God. You heard that. You must believe that what is said is true. You must repent of your sins, meaning that you must change your mind about your actions.
Yes, sir.
You must make a decision that you no longer want to live for you, but you want to live for God. And then you must confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. The same thing that caused him a physical death will cause us spiritual. And it will cause us to be made new in baptism. So as we sing the song of invitation, I want you to go. Thank you.